Before I begin, an advance warning. This video will build off of items discussed in the 13th Age vs. Unity review, and thus will be presented with the assumption that you've got some passing familiarity with 13th Age, or you've seen that previous video. A common argument I've seen over the years is that certain mechanics should have been in the main rulebook. This is often brought up in regard to the breadth of expansions a given game might get. Now, I consider this fallacious because the argument of completeness, in this case, is based more on what people think should be in it, rather than the reality of the situation, barring exceptions of poor design, obviously. Now, full disclosure, I had this attitude at one point, though I didn't do the follow-up of games being more complete in the good old days. And I'll leave a link to John Wick's Blowing Out the Nostalgia Candle rant in the description as it dismantles this in greater detail. More on point, for the longest time I was perplexed by D&D 3rd Edition placing prestige classes in the Dungeon Master's Guide instead of in the Player's Handbook. It wasn't until a few years ago that I learned it was because they ran out of room. Personally, I think they would have had more room if they dialed back on the spells, but that's just me. In many RPGs, shortly after the main book is released, a excess book ends up coming out. I think this is far better than putting it in a book that thematically doesn't make sense, and fortunately these quickly come in bundles with the main book or books. This brings us to 13 True Ways, an expansion to 13th Age, and a first for Gaming Monk Review. This is not a review per se, more of a follow-up to that previous video. While it is breaking my no expansions rule, I feel there's enough to warrant this, and I might try it again in the future. Now, 13 True Ways adds 6 new classes to the game, along with a new set of mechanics on summoning and expansion to the animal companion rules in the main book. We'll be starting with the first class, and the Oddest. The Chaos Mage is akin to wild magic sorcerers in D&D. That is where the similarities end, as the typical Chaos Mage is a few eggs short of a picnic. Paradoxically, the Chaos Mage is simple to play and simultaneously complex to play, which is likely going to make playing it at a physical table a tricky affair. Firstly, you don't choose the spell you know. Instead, you may cast all the spells in a category up to your level. Here's where the first wrinkle is thrown in. This spell list is random between attack, defense, and iconic spells. This is determined by a stone drawing approach, but it can also be determined with dice. While both have their issues as written, I tend to simplify it as a d6 roll that happens during initiative, at the end of a turn, or if an extra action is granted. Furthermore, Chaos Mages have a high weirdness table they roll on when a crit hits them, or if they wish to spend a standard action to reroll the effect. This is a d100 roll that will likely seem familiar to players of Warhammer Fantasy and 40k. This randomness extends to the mage's talents, which range from learning random spells from other classes to generating other random effects. Random being the key word. Fortunately, the casting pool is small, otherwise this class would be an absolute nightmare to handle. The Commander is 13th Age's answer to the Warden class from 4th Edition, a very underrated class in my humble opinion. Like its predecessor, the Commander is the poster child of the frontline general who leads by example. This is the first of the classes to take advantage of the expanded interrupt rules, as their commands will frequently resolve as interrupts. Furthermore, commands take command points, which start at 1, barring any from talents, at the beginning of an encounter. The primary way you gain command points is through the fight from the front and weigh the odds features, the former allowing you to attack and gain points, though slightly less than weigh the odds. The other half of your options are tactics, which unlike commands are resolved as your own actions and don't take command points. However, they're subject to a recharge roll after the encounter. In a sense, commands are your defensive actions, while tactics are your offensive ones. And since they share the same pool of slots, it's a matter of which do you prioritize. Druids are without a doubt the most diverse class presented in 13 True Ways. In a way, it kind of reminds me of the subclass system seen in Legend. Now, putting aside the fact that they can choose strength or dexterity for their melee attacks, each of their talents act like subclasses with 2 forms, Initiate or Adept. The latter is a stronger version with its own options, but costs 2 talents instead of 1. Essentially, you're either an initiate in 3 talents, or an initiate in 1 and adept in another. For example, Animal Companion and Initiate is a slightly weaker version of the Ranger's Animal Companion talent, while the Adept version grants a set of daily spells tied to the Animal Companion. Elemental Caster revolves around summoning elementals and using raw natural magic. Initiate and Adept versions of this determine how many spells you can access. Shifter is the talent for those who like polymorph effects in Druids. This talent grants a small recon transformation called a Scout Form, and a combat-centric transformation called a Beast Form. Where the Initiate-Adept relationship comes in is how many times per day you can transform into either, and how many aspects the beast form can take. Terrain Caster is the talent of choice for those who prefer using land. Much like Elemental Caster, the Initiate-Adept relationship ties into the amount of spells you have access to. Warrior Druid is a kind of dip into the Fighter's flexible attack system. Unlike the Fighter's version, the Warrior Druid's versions are only available once per battle. Finally, Wild Healer is the healing aspect of Druids. While this is a casting talent, it doesn't have the same range as Elemental or Terrain Caster. The only spells it grants are Regeneration, Greater Regeneration, and Wild Heal. The Initiate Adept choice determines how many times you can use each per battle and or per day. Regeneration is an interesting spin on healing, as they use a recovery and then roll saves to try and extend it using free recoveries. All in all, a very simple yet complicated class. The Monk, a class I will hold back my bias on for obvious reasons, has an implementation that reminds me of the Monk class in Final Fantasy XIV because of their three-stage cycle. In this case, a rotating damage die of jab, punch, and kick attacks. This ties into their form abilities, each being akin to a martial arts style, and in and of itself have an opening, flow, and finishing attack. In addition, their talents often have a dual effect of passive or active actions, and a power that draws on a wisdom-based key resource. If I had one complaint about the Monk, it's that they come dangerously close to the multiple ability dependency problem, which I've tried to mitigate by house ruling it so that strength or dexterity is key to their attacks, at the player's discretion. The Necromancer is the second class to take advantage of the summoning rules presented in 13 True Ways. However, this class is not quite as setting neutral as some of the others. While it could be argued that its relationship with the Lich King icon fits into the traditional image of the Necromancer, I think this slightly detracts from the customization battle cry that is 13th Age's greatest strength. Additionally, I find the Wasting Away feature a point of contention. Putting aside how it cuts into the recovery system, it's operating under the assumption that necromancers are going to be played as the typical frail and gaunt figure as they often are in a lot of fiction. While that can certainly apply a lot of cases, the reason why this book is called 13 True Ways is because there's no one true way to play 13th Age. Finally, the Occultist is a caster who's rooted in manipulating fate, reality, and similar esoteric matters. Thematically, they could be seen as a measured spellcaster that rewards and demands patience and picking one's moment. For starters, any healing effect that they are subject to takes hold one round after it was activated. Even drinking a healing potion is subject to this. When it comes to their spellcasting, their spells are based around expending focus. Because gaining focus is a standard action, this means that you can't cast as frequently as others. On the other hand, if you roll low on certain spells, you can still retain focus to try again. Instead of having spell slots, occultists have recharge rolls with a lot of their spells. But where this differs from other recharge rolls is that this isn't tied to the particular spell, but any spell of that level. As a final note, like I mentioned at the top, 13 True Ways introduces a new system for multiclassing. In a way, it's akin to the hybrid class system from D&D 4th edition. In both cases, I appreciate the gesture, but I feel there's more elegant forms of multiclassing within the rules presented. Back in 4th edition's cases, I felt it was through the multiclass feats, and in this case, it can be easily integrated into the talent system. As I said in the initial review, 13 True Ways is an excellent companion for both players and GMs. Some of the classes might be a bit crunchy, but there's plenty of story seeds and motifs to build upon without falling into the default setting trap I've seen in D&D.